Assalamualaikum and a pleasant Wednesday afternoon, everyone. Thank you for
Ya.
being with us again in our Sembang
Yeah.
Santai Teknologi series number 5 with the topic of bagaimana robotik boleh memerangi COVID-19. I am Zura Huzali, the Business Development Director of Favorite, and as usual, I will be the moderator for this English-Malay Santai discussion. Okay? So first of all, allow me to introduce our prominent panelists for today. We have here my boss, Dr. Mazlan Abbas, co-founder and CEO of Favorite, a TEDx speaker who is also ranked among top 50 global thought leaders on the Internet of Things and digital disruption in 2019 by Thinkers360. Next is Mr. Kamaruzaman Jahidin, also known as KJ, chairman and founder principal consultant of PowerNode Solutions Sdn Bhd, currently appointed as InScan's business counselor and have vast experience in the manufacturing sector with more than 13 years of experience in the field of production. And for this amazing topic, we bring you a well-respected figure in robotics, Dr. Hanafia Yusof, who is the founder, board of director and group chief executive officer of Robopreneur Sdn Bhd and recognized as the pioneer in service robotics industry in Malaysia by MIDA. He also holds a prominent position in the robotics community such as chairman of IEEE Robotics and Automation, RAS, Malaysia chapter, visiting professor in some international universities and well-known among robotics scientists and researchers. I'm truly honored to have all of you in our Santai discussion today.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, before we start, I would like to remind all of our members that we will have a quiz towards the end of our series and the top 5 winners we receive KJ's book, Transformasi Diri Menempuh Gelombang Revolusi Industri Forward. Yes,
okay.
with his autograph, okay?
Yeah.
Awesome, thank you. And if you all have missed the previous series, you can always check out our favorite FB page later, okay? So, all right, growing up, we have seen many blockbuster movies where robots are against humanity and taking over the world, okay? But I guess, in reality, robots may, in fact, could be our savior during this pandemic. So for the members' benefit in this series, we shall learn more on the role of robotics, especially during COVID-19 crisis, and how do we see robots after this pandemic is over, inshallah, one day. So to start off, I would like to ask our expert first, Dr. Hanafia. Boleh tak doktor ceritakan sedikit of the history of robots dan bagaimana Robopreneur ditubuhkan? Please, doktor. Okay.
Isteri robot ni sebenarnya panjanglah nak cerita kan.
Aha.
Tapi to summarize thing, actually it's not a new things. It's already been more than 50 years robotics. Early 1942 I think ada seorang fiction writer nama dia Isaac Asimov. Dia come up dengan satu term robot and three laws of robotics. At that time, it's just the beginning of industry revolution 1 and 2. Steam engine and then start going for factory to mass production. And from there, when Industrial Revolution 3.0, when the automotive industry is booming and the mass production is benefit from electricity and also internet, that is where the industrial sector is using a lot of robots to automate their productions, to make to increase the quantity of their product. And this early 1970 to 1980, the early stage where robot entering the industry, and from there 1980 to 1990, I think most of the heavy industry using robot already. From automotive, electronics, semiconductors, and then in 1980 to 1990 also, the research has been started to introduce service robotics to benefit people that outside the scale of factory. Digunakan di luar industri lah. So from there, the term service robotics has been introduced, and we have seen robot being used in other than factory, in hospital, even drone also is also robots, and we have seen drone also taking a lot of job nowadays in industry. And from there, kalau talking about service industry, talking about robotics ni, actually it has three groups of robots.
Alright.
One is the one that we know as the industrial robot that works in the factory, and then another group called service robot, service robotics, which is the robot that works outside the factory. And when industry 4.0 been introduced, the robot inside the factory also want to be smart. Also want to communicate with humans, because service robot is actually the important criteria is the ability to interact with humans, and so ability of the cognitive, maknanya dia ada AI lah, semi AI lah,
Okay, alright.
So now the industry robot also want to be smart, want to have element of communication with human. So in between industrial robot and service robot, ada satu area yang we call it collaborative robots ataupun cobot. So the robot that works in the factory, but they have element of human interactions. So when you're talking about service robotics, actually in Malaysia where when kita banyak kilang-kilang yang menggunakan robot, and it's belong to the industrial robot, and service robot is actually quite new. And from there, service robotic itself ada dua kategori. Ada satu for professional use, and also robot for domestic atau individual use. So under that category, ada lagi sektor-sektor adalah ada yang digunakan untuk education, untuk defense, construction, dan banyak, almost 20 area. Vertical area under the professional use of robots.
Alright.
Under service robotics. So just susur galur itu adalah memang being recognized by in the IFR, which is the national body of international federation of robotics. Dia ada dia punya kategori-kategori tertentu.
Okay.
Jadi di Malaysia, looking into the scope of robotics, where the industrial robot is quite common in Malaysia, service robotics is very very new. And then we started Robopreneur as a pioneer company that focusing into service robotics. And we started from education sector, grew into medical sector, and now on we are focusing more into professional use robots. So ada tiga element. What is the product, technology and applications. So since we are more into application side, so we are focused into the solution based robot and also the technology to enhance the robot capability.
Okay, interesting, Dr. Hanafiah, thank you. So Dr. Mazlan, in your view, apakah peranan ataupun the role of robots in IR 4.0? And before you answer that, someone have told me this before, doctor, that robots have this reputation whereby if they are not stealing your job, they are plotting to take over the entire world. Wow, pengaruh movie sangat kan? Somehow he make it sound like it's going to make a very big impact on the future of our jobs. So my next question to you is, adakah robot boleh mengambil alih pekerjaan, doktor?
Okay, let me share you something.
Okay.
Okay. Eh?
Alright.
So, in relation to IR 4.0, let's take a step back lah. Dan saya pun kalau boleh lebih suka cakap dalam bahasa Malaysia juga, Zura.
Okay. Thank you.
Dalam
no problem.
Era satu pelang kosong. Apa yang kita lihat bahawa dalam industri 4.0, dalam sektor manufacturing, dia lebih kepada penggunaan steam engine dan sebagainya. Tapi kalau secara meluasnya, kalau kita lihat, dia lebih kepada manual dengan physical tool. Ini bermakna apa saja penggunaan yang masih menggunakan tenaga kerja, kita adalah dalam era 1.0. Jadi dalam era IR 2.0 tu apabila elektrik diperkenalkan, jadi kilang pun dah mempunyai mesin yang mempunyai power daripada elektrik, dan dia lebih memudahkan untuk buat mass production lah. Dan ini kita katakan kita di dalam era 2.0. Dalam era 3.0, bila elektronik diperkenalkan, chipset, internet dan sebagainya, kita lihat bahawa database kita dia dalam bentuk digitalization. So dalam era ini ada era 3.0, di mana inilah kita berada sekarang kebanyakannya yang menggunakan internet dan komputer dan sebagainya. Tetapi dalam era 4.0 tu apabila intelligence tu dah dimasukkan dalam sistem kita. Jadi ini bermakna bahawa intelligence ini datang daripada berbagai-bagai teknologi lah. Jadi antara teknologi macam kita yang buat selalu ialah Internet of Things kan. Lagi banyak juga teknologi seperti blockchain, robotics, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, drones. Ini semua adalah teknologi yang mempunyai kepakaran, some intelligence in that. So that is the era of 4.0. Sesiapa yang menggunakan teknologi ni, mereka berada dalam era ni lah. Jadi kalau kita tengok sebagai contoh lah, dalam bidang IR 4.0 in education, kita kata kita education berapa? Education 4.0 ataupun 1.0. Jadi kalau era 1.0, teknologi tak ada. Kita hanya menggunakan physical tool, papan hitam, whiteboard, that is 1.0.
Right.
So the moment kita gunakan transparency, masih menggunakan tangan tapi menggunakan electrical, OHP, overhead projector, that is era 2.0 education sector kita. Tapi tak adalah, saya rasa sekarang kita pun dah berubah, kita ada online, kita ada computer projector dan kita guna online learning, that is 3.0. Tapi bagaimanakah kalau kita berada di era 4.0? Ini digunakan robot, you know, robot membantu kita, artificial intelligence, virtual reality. Ini perbezaannya apabila penggunaan teknologi ini berubah. Jadi dalam setiap sektor, apa yang kita lihat bukan setakat barang itu berubah, tetapi pekerjaan, cara kita mengajar pun, pembelajaran mesti akan berubah. Jadi sebagai contohlah, adakah kita rasakan macam Zura kata tadi, ada planning to take all over the world macam Terminator? Mungkin ya, mungkin tidak. Tapi kalau kita lihat pun movie, apa yang berlaku zaman dahulu, Star Wars pun, kita dah tengok sekarang Star Wars pun hampir-hampir berlaku sekarang kan, benda-benda teknologi tu dah ada. Jadi kita tengok adakah robot ni boleh menggantikan customer service. You know, kita boleh lihat banyak di Jepun, di SoftBank menggunakan robot untuk sebagai customer service. Dan mungkin dia mengambil alih kita punya citizenship, macam Sofia ni kan, yang datang kat Malaysia ni. Dia dah juga kan? Orang tak bercakap lah. Jadi Sofia ni kemungkinan akan mengambil alih citizenship kita dan mengalih kerja kita kan. Dan macam Simon tu adalah satu alat robot yang bulat, dia boleh terbang dan boleh menggantikan astronot kan? Dan terlihat juga bahawa robot ni boleh dalam sektor-sektor yang lain lah, macam Dr. Nafiah cakap, mungkin dalam defense dan sebagainya. Jadi persoalannya sama ada robot ni boleh mengambil pekerjaan kita sekarang atau tidak. Jadi tengoklah, bergantung pada pekerjaan kita. Kalau kita nak bekerja dalam era IR 1.0, tentulah akan diambil alih kan. Jadi sebagai engineer katakan, kalau engineer tu dia telah buat survey lah, likelihood of automation or robotics ni boleh take over the engineers. Tapi sebab engineers ni dia ada creativity, dia ada innovativeness dan sebagainya. So they have difficulty for the robot to replace them. So in term of job wise, they are least likely to be replaced. So siapa engineer tu selamat lah. So kalau dia sebagai apa kita orang tu medical practitioner. Sorry. So kalau dia dalam medical practitioner, tentulah macam sekarang yang berlaku robot dan nurse sebagainya, itu kita akan ceritalah COVID-19 dia boleh replace robot atau tidak, robot boleh replace dia atau tidak. Tapi selalunya kalau kita lihat, robot susah nak replace orang-orang yang mempunyai empathy. Takkanlah yang jenis sakit dia ikut rule je. Kalau you datang kemudian, kita akan lihat you kemudian dengan you follow dengan robot cara macam itu. Tapi sebabkan robot ni susah nak dapatkan empathy, kita sebagai manusia melihat sesuatu tu berdasarkan perasaan kita, emotion, mungkin susah dia nak ubah.
Right.
Nurses, jururawat, agak senang robot nak ambil alih. Dia berkeras je benda ni, dia robot ni kalau lembut. Manusia ni dia lebih pada perasaan. Jadi agak sukar untuk mereka mengambil alih pekerjaan seperti medical practitioners lah. Kalau kita lihat construction worker, malang lah. Malangnya construction worker ni because dia very, macam robot ni selalu dia akan ambil alih kerja di mana kita tak ada kekuatan, dia ada kekuatan. Kalau kita selalu lupa, robot boleh ambil alih. Dan tempat-tempat yang kerja yang agak susah, sukar dan bahaya, mungkin robot boleh ambil alih. Jadi construction worker ni adalah satu yang repetitif. Dan boleh diambil alih mudah oleh robot. So mungkin dalam era yang akan selepas post-COVID ni, mungkin construction worker dah makin berkurang. So janganlah jadi construction worker kan.
Okay, Syekh Jelin.
So dia ada website ni. So siapa yang minat pergi kepada website ni, dia pergi website ni tengok. Dan dia kata okay, dia boleh letak pekerjaannya, check pekerjaannya apa yang dia nak jadi di masa akan datang. Bila dia dah graduate ke, dia nak kerja apa. I am a library clerk. How many percent likely that you're going to be replaced? If you're a clerk, how many percent? So Zura, business development.
Oh my god.
To be replaced.
Dia kena ada
business.
Dia konon. Selamat, nak kena selamat ni.
Ya.
Okay, cool. So you, apa, everyone can just apa you check from this site doktor ya?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Alright. So thank you. Moving on with KJ. Since we know you have a vast experience in the manufacturing sector before as well, kan? Yeah, I would like to ask you, apa pula peranan robot dalam sektor pembuatan di kilang?
Okay. Alright. Thanks, Zura. Assalamualaikum semua. Apa khabar? Tamat berpuasa, lagi berapa jam nak buka, sabar.
Amboi. Relax.
Robot tak ada insting, saya bukan robot. Saya ada insting, so kena ada benda-benda macam tu.
Okay.
Malam lepas Moray, Zura. Baru lepas Moray, tengah-tengah minum, tengok Robocop. Tengok Robocop pula. Allah, hari ni cerita pasal robot pula kan. Masa saya belajar tu, saya punya favourite animation movie is Ultron. Talking about robot lah.
I see.
Doktor ingat Ultron, ingat tak Ultron?
Selalu yang Terminator tu lah. Yang tu, I tengok lah.
Dia tengok umur ni.
Tengok umur.
Generasi mana ni?
Saya baby boomer C.
Generation C.
Okay, Doktor, izinkan saya share slide?
Boleh.
Alright. Dapat eh?
Yes.
Okay. So, why robotic? Saya kata why robotic kan, dia macam cak kan. Am I taking over your job or not? Okay, basically dalam case ni lah, saya nampak dalam manufacturing ni basically what robotic is been used is to replace repetitive work lah. Satu, yang keduanya benda yang related dengan 3D, it is dangerous, which is difficult and also dirty. So banyak case sebelum ni lah, kalau masa zaman saya dulu pada tahun 1990s lah. So we are use a lot of human ataupun workforce labor lah. Tapi isu dia pula bila kita pakai workforce labor ni, kita punya dalam manufacturing, kita punya pain point tu sangat tinggi. Sebab untuk pengetahuan semua, manufacturing ni dia punya profit margin ni, kalau siapa boleh hit 30%, memang dia dahsyat lah. We never hit 30% of manufacturing punya profit. Normally Japanese lah, saya punya base Japanese. Dia boleh pergi 20 pun dia kira macam, oh dahsyat lah. So those yang buat money is not the manufacturing, but those yang buat money is the marketing. So Zura, you are safe. You are doing a business development writer.
Alhamdulillah. So thank you for the good news.
Robot cannot sell, Zura. You can sell. Okay. So dalam pinpoint ni, ada isu-isu dia. Isu pertama adalah we are too depending on labor. So kalau dulu kita banyak pakai local workers. So later on, bila zaman saya tu, saya dah start panggil foreign workers. We take Bangladesh, Indonesia and so forth. And then, memang kita nampak dia punya attendance tu bagus. Tapi apabila dia problems nanti, attendance dia pun akan problem. Eh, then human he tends to have like moody, too moody. Okay, so ada time-time dia nak, sorry wah Zura, time Monica kan, dia ada time-time dia lah kan. Lucky dia consistent lah doktor kan.
Okay. I give it to you.
So dalam manufacturing, if we can make 95% of attendance every day, we are in the safe zone. But we never get that. Normally what we are getting is around 90, 89, 92. So normally bila kita buat calculations of output, kita akan ambil at least 10% of attendance punya problems to cover. Cover tu kadang-kadang kita buat overtime dan sebagainya. So overtime ni pun satu masalah juga, duit juga lagi. Okay, dan satu lagi bila manpower ni tidak ada atau tidak konsisten, we having difficulties on the speed. Yeah, nak dapat konsisten on the speed tu susah. Kadang-kadang kita ada masalah orang pergi ke tandas, seorang kalau time rehat kan dia makan tengok laut sedap, dia makan over pula kan. Bila dia makan over dah jadi too loaded kan. So bila too loaded kan, dia punya movement, hands semua dah jadi macam long line je. Instead of dia buat A, dia pergi buat B. Kadang dia miss the A. Kadang dia buat B, dia buat B tu double daripada A. Dia ingat the point A tu dia tengok benda dah berpina. Bila kita dah makan tu, masalah kita punya mata ni dah kabur. Right? And then bila kita ada all this problem, then they finally come back to the quality. That's why dalam manufacturing, if we fail to manage the quality, we'll be in the big troubles lah. Okay. So, macam saya pernah cakap itu, what we in the manufacturing is to eliminate this all the 8 wastages. So, these 8 wastages ni dalam konteks Toyota manufacturing dipanggil lean manufacturing lah. Eh? Lean production system. So, kalau tengok dalam ni, kita ada contohnya kita ada motion. Motion. So, motion, defects, transportation, ini semua can be replaced by robot because we need to have a quality. So, contoh macam dekat sini kita tengok orang welding. Eh? Macam kereta lah. Kalau Zura tengok kereta ni, berapa ribu points dia ada dalam satu kereta?
Beribu-ribu kot.
Beribu-ribu. Beribu-ribu tu bukan di luar ke, di dalam. Yeah. Dalam dashboard, dalam ni. You cannot miss one point of the welding. If you miss one point of learning, how critical is the kereta nanti? So kita tak nak cakap kereta national lah. We talk about others juga lah. Okay. Right. So that's why we are in the midst of getting a quality product. So sometimes our local product is difficult to sell overseas because we don't have these kind of things. So with the robots punya helps ni, we are eliminating something else. Contoh. Satu lagi, saya ingat lagi, saya pergi Japan tahun 1992. Lama je lah. AGV dah ada kat sana. Kan? So, dekat kita, dekat Malaysia ni, kita ada 3-4-5 orang. Kerja dia tolak barang. Ambil barang daripada warehouse, pakai, apa nama ni, saya pun dah lupa, trolley ke apa ke. Dan tolak sampailah ke line. Likewise, this AGV, dia ada line. So, dia ada line. Spoiler program kan siap-siap barang apa nak habis, so dia akan pick up, everything is very smooth. And then dia ada sensor lah, bila ada obstacle tengah-tengah dia akan berhenti dan dia akan jalan balik. So kita buang sampah ke apa, semua memang saya rasa memang menarik lah kan kat sana lah.
Nice.
So that was 1992. So after that changes pun, saya tengok tak ada banyak perubahan pun dekat Malaysia.
I see. Alright.
So when you talk about dalam factory pun ada warehouse. Dalam warehouse pun dia besar. Eh? Kalau tengok macam Amazon, macam Lazada, Shopee. Now the COVID-19 ni dia makin lama makin ramai orang shopping online. So one of the local, not local lah, one of the top online shoppers ni, shopping ni. Dia punya increase of sales about 300%.
Wow.
So dia tak boleh, dia can't afford to delay dia punya delivery.
Yeah.
So kalau tengok dalam warehouse ni, kita punya movement dalam warehouse ni is lost 60%. Macam orang cari barang, contohlah kita pergi IKEA lah, kita nak cari aisle mana aisle ni kan. Tu pantai kan.
Right.
Kita jumpa pula atas pula, tinggi pula kan. So this robot basically dia dah program to cari where is the locations of the material. It's focused. Macam kita kan jalan, oh assalamualaikum, waalaikumsalam. Eh, borak lagi lah, membawa.
Banyak
lah.
Terdelay dia.
Line dah stop dah ni. So, kita tak boleh afford je. I can afford. Dalam saya punya contact dulu, saya tak dapat satu pun output, saya akan jawab. Kalau target 2,000, saya dapat 1,999. Sampai dekat bos besar, apa MD, Kamal Sam, why one only, don't get.
Oh my God. Aduh eh, takutnya.
Yes, that's how difficult, not difficult lah, how significant is the production.
Yes.
Okay, itu saya cerita pasal electronics punya manufacturing. Tapi kalau kita cerita lagi pasal lain, lagi banyak sebenarnya.
Right.
So, what actually robot is helping us, actually dia bukan replace. Dia actually dia helping us. So, takkan kita nak bawa, apa nama ni, material ni seberat 100 kilo. So we need robot. So 100 kilo, tarik satu hari, okey lagi. Dua hari, okey lagi. Masuk sebulan, semua tulang-tulang patah, bengkok, leput. Lepas tu, itu yang banyak kita makan ubat suplemen kan. Bila makan ubat suplemen tu, jadi masalah.
That's right.
That is my experience lah dalam manufacturing.
Okay, cool. Alright, so, I mean, fascinating what you're sharing with us. Okay, back to Dr. Hanafiah. Actually, this is the most awaited question that I would like to ask you today, Doctor. I believe you saw some silver linings in the current situation. Bagaimana peranan robot ketika COVID-19 ni, Doctor? How are robotics making a difference in this crisis? Please.
Okay, back to the early question. Apa sama ada robot akan mengambil alih manusia, kerja manusia kan? Tapi terbuktilah sebenarnya robot ni menyelamatkan manusia, bukannya mengambil alih.
Yeah.
Yang mengambil alih kerja manusia ni adalah for current context the virus lah kan. And so actually when a new technology be introduced, it's actually a common untuk kita sebagai manusia ni ada sedikit rasa sangsi lah. Rasa takut nak mencuba kan. Rasa,
sorry Dr. Nafe, do you have anything to show on the slide? Tak ada? Kalau tak ada, KJ boleh?
Alright, no problem.
Sebab kan sembang santai ni tanpa slide.
Boleh. Kita okay je.
Yeah. So,
just KJ, maybe can stop there, your slide first, just now. Yeah.
I nak buat gambar tu besar, 4 orang ni kat depan.
Oops.
Kita boleh control tak?
Okay. Dr. Hanafiah, maybe you can just continue.
Alright, so again,
thank you.
In talking about COVID-19 ni, it's actually very, very sudden things lah kan.
Yep.
And we have been actually promoting robotics ni for the purpose of one of it is for emergency use lah. Right? If you still remember when Fukushima nuclear plant was exploded, at that time it was a big crisis in Japan. And a part of surveillance purpose, they have deployed a robot to do surveillance. From that surveillance data, the following countermeasure can be done. Sama ada nak hantar tim pergi repair ke, nak tengok apa, still ada orang kat dalam ke dan sebagainya kan. Jadi dalam konteks COVID-19 ni, kita boleh tengok dari segi during the lockdown and after the lockdown, I think. Sebab during the lockdown, kita banyak fokus kepada supporting the frontliners and also for activities yang melibatkan prevention of people from going out, kan? And then untuk mengelakkan cross infection ya dan sebagainya. Jadi banyak keperluan tu masih dalam skill hospital, skill keselamatan ya, dan dekat situ disebabkan kalau kita tengok konteks Malaysia ni sebab kita tak bersedia basic robotics. Jadi kita punya robotik banyak kat kilang, ya, macam kerja cakap tu memang well established, ya.
Right.
But then luckily in Malaysia we have a few companies, like Propreneur, DF Automations and several other companies yang we are doing a very specific task. Kita ada specific task yang yang mana sebahagian daripada tu kita boleh pick up, combine and put it as emergency countermeasure for this COVID-19. Oh. And alhamdulillah, DF Automation come up with the Makcik Kia robot. And then some of us also coming up with some other robot that at the standby mode. Standby mode, kalau diperlukan, kita akan ke depan.
I see. Hmm. Okay.
And MOSTI dan juga MTDC is playing very important role to bringing this technology upfront. And kita pun melihat untuk jangka masa pendek dan juga jangka masa panjang. Dan ke, balik pada yang saya mention tadi about during lockdown and after lockdown. So during lockdown kita nampak keperluan dia jelas. Dan kita dah ada beberapa robot yang ready to be deployed. And then when we talking about after the MCO, after the lockdown, this is more serious actually. Sebab the skill is bigger than what we have during lockdown. The scale of people going out doing their daily life and pergi kerja, even dua hari lepas pun, sehari sebelum 4 hari bulan tu saya tengok kat jalan raya dah ramai orang.
Yeah, it is.
Jadi social distancing, untuk disinfections, tracking. So dekat ini, saat inilah yang paling mencabar sekali. Bila kita mula buka pintu rumah kita keluar, sebab kita perlu apa, rolling the economics, kita perlukan that economics to be back as usual. Jadi kita perlu bekerja, kedai perlu menjual, kita perlu membeli, baru kita dapat rolling the economics.
Right.
So this how people have to go out, and at the same time role is role. Tapi discipline is very very difficult to be implemented when we go into the real application. Bila nak pergi makan tengah hari kedai mama tengah perut dah lapar, kan? Nah.
Jangan puasa.
Kan? Jadi, nak kata 1 meter tu pun agak-agak lah. 20 meter, kan?
Right.
Apa, 50 cm, kan? Susah nak control. Jadi kat sini sangat mencabar kalau kita tengok dari segi public lah. Dan sebenarnya kalau kita ambil contoh di China, dekat Korea, kan, sebab pada dasarnya dia orang bersedia, teknologi dia orang dah ada, dan bila dalam masa krisis macam ni, sama ada company ataupun government side, they are ready to deploy the robot and also other device be part of the langkah-langkah pencegahan dan juga untuk digunakan lah, ya. Jadi Malaysia kita belum bersedia, tapi kita perlu melakukan sesuatu lah dalam masa yang terdekat ni. Dan satu yang kita kena tengok dari segi macam mana kita nak memastikan disiplin yang KKM bagi yang kita kena ikut tu, social distancing semua tu, macam mana kita nak make sure that been followed di public, di shopping mall, di train station, so kita boleh guna konsep AGV yang macam KJ tunjuk tadi, kan, sebab the mobility of platform tu, as long as it can moving in the autonomous way and we can control dia punya track dan sebagainya. Yang penting adalah apa yang kita put on top of it. Kita boleh letak kamera for surveillance. Kita boleh letak alarm untuk measure distancing of the people that lining up. Either they are actually too close, or they can the robot can give some alarm to make sure that people follow the rule, kan. So untuk enforcing the discipline, so kat sini yang mencabar, dan saya rasa kalau kita bergantung sepenuhnya pada manusia, memang kita agak susah. Jadi robot boleh mengambil alih satu tugas ni. And then bukan hanya ground robot ya. Kalau kita AGV ni is a ground type robot. Kita boleh juga macam gunakan aerial robot. Kita boleh gunakan drone untuk surveillance, untuk memastikan kawasan-kawasan yang terlalu crowded, yang mana lepas tu mungkin dia boleh panggil alam kepada polis, polis akan datang. Macam yang berlaku baru-baru ini kat restoran mana tu. Yeah. Jadi ground robot, air aerial robot, ini yang boleh digunakan untuk post MCO. Dan satu lagi yang penting yang boleh membantu dari segi AI, kita tengok AI ni satu kalau dekat robot tu, mana robot tu ada intelligent lah. Tapi kita juga perlu tengok dari segi mission vision tu. Maksudnya AI yang bukan ada pada hardware, AI yang ada pada vision sensor, pada IoT, data analytics, untuk contact tracing. So macam mana data ni dapat digunakan sebagai satu medium untuk memastikan disiplin kita terjaga. Sebab ini penting supaya kita dapat terus bertahan dari segi ekonomi, dan juga kita tak perlu buat MCO buat kali kedua. Semua pun nak balik raya. Jadi itu yang kita, yang cabaran yang bagi saya perlulah.
Okay. Alright. So I guess kalau ada robot ni dekat kita punya healthcare punya front lines pun, it will be safe for them, and then social distancing pun will come naturally too, kan? So I figured robot plays an important role in fighting COVID-19 around the globe, as what Dr. Hanafi have shared with us just now, which is so amazing. So Dr. Mazlan, is that why robot ditekankan dalam pendidikan, doktor? Or is there any other reasons mengapa ditekankan, doktor?
I have to make a confession dekat sini, you know.
You takut. Okay. What kind of confession is that?
Dulu, you know, cita-cita sebenarnya nak reka robot.
Oh, okay.
At that time, tahun 1960-an, manalah ada orang fikir nak buat robot, kan? The only robot yang kita nampak is dalam TV tu kartun saja, kan? Space Odyssey, you know, the hall, yeah. So that robot. So minat, datang minat tu sebabkan ada kartun tu, ada filem dan movie yang menarik minat kita. Dan saya pun tertarik juga kenapa macam negara China yang macam Dr. Hanifah mention. Saya lihat satu dokumentari, dalam masa 2 minggu dia boleh produce satu robot. Cepat, sebab dalam bangunan tu, all the components necessary for making the robot is there. Anything lah you cakap. Dia boleh cari aja dalam bangunan tu, banyak macam komponen, apa unit number dan sebagainya, semua ada dalam kat situ. Jadi within 2 weeks, they come out with the robot. Dan kita, saya pun terfikir dahulu, fikir robot tu macam manusia. Sebenarnya baru sekarang kita tahu robot tu tak semesti macam manusia juga. Dia macam-macam bentuk.
Right.
Ada tangan sebelah, ada kaki ke, ada badan, dia tak bentuk muka pun ada juga. Jadi kalau kita lihat kepentingan robot ni, saya pun share slide ni sekali lah.
Okay.
Jadi kalau robot ni, the idea of the robot is actually to mimic a human. That is the ultimate game. But the question is macam Terminator lah, kan? Tapi the question is, how do we mimic a machine to become like a human? That is the most toughest part in developing or creating a robot. So kalau kita tengok sekarang pun macam-macam jenis robot lah, itu yang nak menarik minat student. Jadi sekarang kita lihat, barulah topik-topik ini di embed dalam silibus budak-budak sekolah sebagainya. Tapi di luar negara, mereka telah buat ni dah lama dah. Sebab apa? Kalau kita tengok lihat, kita lihat teknologi yang dalam robot tu banyak sebenarnya. Dia bukan satu benda robotik. It's not only robotik that you want to learn, but there are various components inside the robot. So this education, dia kena start. First, dia kena cari minat lah. Minat bentuk robot tu, rupa dia, tangan dia bergerak. Jadi dia datang minat dia. Macam sekarang kita buat drone, kan? Semua sekolah-sekolah semua ada drone, ada kontes drone lah, kontes robot, you know, challenge dan sebagainya. Itu hanya untuk menarik minat. Tapi berapa lama kita nak menggunakan minat cara main game ni saja untuk adakah dia boleh menarik minat sehingga kita boleh membina satu robot, membangunkan robot tersebut? kita nak lebih jauh, kita nak langkah lebih jauh sikit. Jangan setakat menggunakan. Macam saya kata dulu, kita tak mau jadi a consumer nation. We want to become a producer nation. Itu yang kita lihat robotpreneur pun, saya tabik lah. Saya because respect that robotpreneur now is making a robot Adam, kan? So that yes. Adam is our first Malaysian robot yang bentuknya very macam Robocop, kan? So that's how we need our people to build a robot. So in case like this, kita tengok kan, kalau the components of robot tu banyak. Dia structure, you have to know. Dia power source tu, you must make it standalone. Takkanlah sentiasa ada wire je. Gak mana tak ada wire, you want to, this robot to work without electrical cord, kan? And right. Then you want to make sure the actuation, dia boleh control the way they kena sensing, IoT sensors inside dalam robot tu. Macam mana dia manipulate dia punya tangan, macam mana dia bergerak, and then dia punya intelligence part. So all of this requires different technologies to be embedded into this robot. Because kita as human is very complex, a very complex human being. So there are many things yang Allah kita bagi ke kita, kita kalau hilang satu baru kita rasa bersyukur, kita patutnya ada benda tu. Tapi yes. kita tak terfikir benda tu. Tapi bila kita nak buat robot baru kita tahu begitu mencabar sekali. Bukan apa penciptaan Allah ni begitu perfect. And we as human cannot design a robot like this, like what Allah have already give us to us, ciptaan kat kita, kan. So kalau kita teknologi, electronics, that's why kita kena belajar electronics kat sekolah, kan. Electronics kat university, kita kena tahu how the electrical power looks like, kan. Battery tu kita stable tidak, kan. And then kita know how the way that we can control things. Coding, belajar coding, software to program the robot. 3D printing, nak buat robot bentuk-bentuk macam mana. IoT, itulah IoT digunakan. Sensors banyak dalam perbadan robot tu. Kemudian kita nak make that artificial intelligence, the way that we need to make that image processing, the video processing part. That's where kita buat artificial intelligence. So all of this requires so many technologies within a single robot. Tu kalau kita tengok apa tu sebagai contoh this mass robot autonomous vehicle, dia pun robot jugalah, kan. Dia sebagai ada robot. Sebelum Amerika menghantar robot ni atau this dekat Mars, bulan di planet Mars, macam mana dia nak control? So they have to ensure this vehicle can work on its own. So dia ada intelligence, dia ada all the sensors inside there to apa kata orang tu, untuk mengatasi apa saja masalah. Jadi apa yang mereka buat, dia buat kat sekolah di universiti, dia buat satu kereta dan dia letak all the necessary lidar dan sebagainya, sensors dan sebagainya, dan dia travel on its own. So dia guna tu, dia buat kontes. Dia can jalan, dia bergerak sendiri sepanjang pertandingan tu, siapa yang boleh lepas dalam desert tu. Bila dia dapat buat benda ni, barulah dia boleh menghantar this expensive equipment dekat planet Mars. Tak boleh hantar berjuta-juta lepas tu tersangkut, baru 1 meter dia kena sangkut situ, kan. So there must be a way of how this robot can stand on its own. So all this technology ni very important. That's why kita belajar kat universiti. Banyak benda yang kita belajar kita tak tahu. Tapi bila kita buat robot, baru kita tahu. Kita memerlukan kepakaran yang berbeza-beza. I think Dr. Nafiah lebih pakar lah dalam bidang ni, kan. Saya hanya
sekali saja. Okay. Alright. Thank you Dr. Mazlan. Now back to you KJ. People usually will say that they still want to have a human element lah, okay, to their interaction instead of robots. You know, it's kind of essential for us to have that human touch. Somehow in our discussion, we realize yang COVID-19 ni have changed that. Robots can actually help to overcome the crisis. But the question is, are the robots here to stay? Bagaimana kita melihat robot ni selepas COVID-19 ni, KJ?
Macam saya, kita punya siri sembang yang sebelum ni, kan, saya ada tunjuk satu slide di mana robot digunakan dalam hospital, kan.
Right.
So macam saya cakap, kenapa work sekarang baru keluar, kenapa dulu tak keluar?
Lambat. Kan?
Lambat, bukan lambat, tak tahulah macam mana saya nak cakap. Mungkin keadaan tidak memaksa kita pakai.
The needs lah.
Tapi sebagai macam Dr. Mazlan cakap, sebagai negara, bakal negara yang menjadi negara apa, producing nation ni, kan. So kita kena keluar kita punya aset ni, tunjuk dengan negara-negara luar, yeah, we have this, we have that, we have this. Adam is coming in. Saya pun tengok Adam, lawa pula Adam ni, macam robot kau juga. Color is striking, kan.
Yes. So,
pada saya, penggunaan robot ni macam awal-awal saya cakap tadi, dia bukan nak replace human, don't worry, dia complement to each other. Dalam factory pun, dalam factory pun, factory ni kena ada orang. Bukan tak ada orang, kena ada orang. So orang ni yang akan monitor robot ni buat kerja. Bukan sebelum ni kita tengok kita yang buat kerja kan. So, right. Kita monitor robot ni buat kerja sebab robot ni maintenance macam kita juga. Kita kena ada apa nama ni, kena ada rehat dan sebagainya. Cuma robot ni dia tak ada, dia tak tahu penat. Dia buat je tapi anyhow kita kena maintain dia.
Betul.
So kalau kita tak maintain dia macam mana kita nak jalan seterusnya kan? Robot dia tu. Robocat.
Okay. Aduh. Aha.
Okay, so bagaimana penggunaan teknologi, apa penggunaan robot dalam lepas COVID ni, saya rasa lah, saya harap lah, saya harap benda ni berterusan. Harap berterusan. So, right. cuma macam saya pagi tadi, saya ada cakap dengan RTM Selangor kan. Ada sesi pagi tadi. Apakah dia evolusi teknologi? Evolusi teknologi ni sebenarnya transformasi. Transformasi teknologi dengan perkembangan masyarakat. So, bagaimana masyarakat menerima teknologi? So dalam kes kita, dalam sekarang kes COVID-19 ni, kita dipaksa dan memaksa diri kita keluar daripada kepompong menggunakan teknologi. Kan? Which is not good lah. Might as well kita redor, kita suka guna benda tu. Kita suka benda tak guna. Contohnya macam robot dekat hospital, welcome us, don't touch. Macam Dr. Anafiah kata tadi, apa nama ni, AGV robot, lalu boleh tengok CCTV yang ada, kamera boleh push some notification, please kekalkan jarak 1 meter. Jadi polis ni boleh buat kerja-kerja lain.
Betul.
Ni jenayah-jenayah dah mula balik ni kan.
Dia dah start doing. Pada old norm balik.
Dia dah start balik. So kita worried on that. So macam saya buat dulu di selatan Malaysia, ada cadangan nak buat Robo City tau. Oh, saya very excited masa tu. So idea-idea Robo City. Ada idea saya nak buat macam apa tau. Robot ni ada dekat tepi jalan, dekat tepi koridor lah. Dia boleh detect sampah. So sampah ada je, dia pergi ambil, dia kutip. Dan dia remind orang, please clean the area dan sebagainya. So macam pagi tadi saya cakap, teknologi robot ni ataupun teknologi yang apa kita ada sekarang ni menginsankan manusia. So kita kena insan balik. Sebelum ni kan kita tak insan kan. So kita dengan penggunaan teknologi ni, kita menginsankan seinsan-insannya kita sebelum ni.
Very good. Okay. So what would be your thought on this, Dr. Anafiah?
Well, COVID-19 ni actually is a wake up call lah. Kita pun tak expect this things happen. Yeah? Actually 1998 is the best time when kita start talking about 4.0. It's the best time kita highlight robotics and AI within Malaysian landscape lah. And then 2019 it was the best year. And then 2020 kita feels that robotics AI ni a bit slowing down sebab kita punya economics is not so good. Okay? And then when COVID-19 happened, and it's actually it's a health crisis, but at the same time it's a wake up call to show that where the robotics is actually can play a role, especially during a crisis time. Human previously, orang cakap nak buat satu robot, even nak buat Adam, this like 4-5 million for that project, you know.
Right.
It's very expensive. You're going to justify 4-5 million to just develop a prototype robot, kan? Tapi, can you compare a single human life with the value of 4-5 million? Yeah? Kan? It's priceless, human's life. Kan?
Yes.
So, kalau we spend like 5 million to develop a robot that can save one life, right? I think it's you can justify that. You can justify that. It's just and this COVID-19, when people getting very stressed to get whatever solution untuk membantu, right? And you know, when we at the front line, you go into the place where the deadly virus is there, you know. It's like going to the nuclear plant that's already exploded. You are exposed. And then you're coming back to your family, somehow maybe a tiny virus is with you already kan. Jadi ketakutan ni ya, memberi satu impak juga kepada kita semua untuk melihat teknologi ni lebih lebih serius, lebih mendalam kan. Dan saya tengok apa di sebalik krisis ni ada opportunity yang baik untuk robotics untuk contribute and also show that this technology is also is not only bringing the economy growth, the growth of the economy, tapi juga for the good of the humanity to save life.
Right. Okay. Sorry, you have more to say?
Yes, a little bit. Saya tengok selepas COVID-19 ni, saya harap the government, Malaysia government will look seriously into the development of robotics to get more people to get involved into developing robots, get the business robots, especially on the service robotics area. And then kita perlu ada good ecosystem dan supply chain lah. Macam Dr. Mazlan cakap tadi kan, you nak build up a robot in 2 weeks, you need to have all the component to be there at one place. Eh? You need to have a maker for sensor, motor, electronics thing to be at one place. Eh? Yes. So in Malaysia, kita lacking on that. Most when we develop Adam, more than 80% of the component is from overseas. Eh? It's hard to find a local manufacturer for specific component lah, untuk build up a robot. And it's not only require one area saja, kita perlukan banyak multidisciplinary to come up in one project kan. Jadi the ecosystem must be developed. Eh? Kita perlu ada syarikat yang buat sensor, kita perlu ada syarikat yang buat electric motor, kita perlu ada company yang buat apa tu, ada electrical components. Eh? Jadi from there baru kita dapat develop satu produk yang so called Malaysia made lah. Eh? Sama, saya rasa konsep ni sama yang masa kita nak come up dengan automotive punya produk 20-30 years ago. Eh? Kita develop punya ekosistem. Kita develop contract apa, company producer yang boleh support the industry. So we cannot suddenly come up with one robot out of nowhere. Eh? So now if we still buying component from overseas, we are not in control of that technology. Eh? Kita tak membina teknologi, kita hanya membina produk. Eh? Jadi to be strong into to be economical strong, kita bukan hanya perlu produce produk, tapi kita kena ada teknologi tu. Maknanya ekosistem tu kita kena develop. We need to secure that technology within this country. Baru kita ada kekuatan dari segi ekonomi, and we can produce not only product, we can produce technology, we can have you know, the more people to venture into robotic as well. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Hanafiah. Perhaps you can actually see dekat kita punya comments or some concerns from our members here. Zulkifli Zainal is saying, adakah industri di Malaysia bersedia atau berkemampuan untuk membantu seperti di Vinfast Vietnam? Nature business yang berbeza, tetapi kemampuan kerjasama R&D yang pantas untuk menghasilkan produk yang baru. Dr. Hanafiah, maybe you would like to answer this?
Panjang soalan tadi.
Adakah industri di Malaysia bersedia atau mampu untuk membantu seperti di Vinfast Vietnam?
Okay, kita Vietnam is very kata tu aggressive country lah, yeah, and they learn very fast. Yeah. Industri kita sebenarnya Malaysia is very we are a manufacturing company. Kita produce lot of components, but most of the components kita dedicated to automotive and semiconductor. This is two big industry in Malaysia lah. Yeah. And aside from the food industry, yeah, in talking about more itu on heavy industry. Dan kita tak nafikan ada company ataupun industri yang kat Malaysia ni, the level is actually world level. They are producing a component and product for world market, bukan hanya untuk Malaysia. Eh. Ada company yang tertentu di Penang contohnya yang produce part yang digunakan dalam iPhone. Jadi kita dari segi capability kita memang ada, cuma dari segi planning untuk certain industry, if we done very well in automotive also semiconductor, why not we try to develop for the robotics, eh? Because this is the future. Tadi KJ cakap the margin for manufacturing is actually very low, eh? And I memang saya setuju, eh? Kalau you venture into manufacturing to get 20% is actually almost miracle, eh? So but when you talking about robotics, dia unique sikit, eh? The robotics ni dia the factory need to be flexible. Maksudnya you cannot just produce one type of platform, one type of robot. You must flexible enough to customize according to the customer needs. So nak tak nak R&D kena ada. Yeah. You cannot just be purely manufacturing punya factory. You need to have a R&D team to do the product development according to the clients punya keperluan, ya. Eh? Contoh macam oil and gas, dia perlukan robot untuk underwater punya explorations, kan? The parameter is different. The customization need to be there. Yeah. Kalau kita nak, for example, time dah become to for the plantation, berbeza juga. Yeah. Tapi kita memerlukan apa? Mungkin group of people, tapi have the various multitask punya knowledge. And then when the R&D is mature enough to customize into the needs of the clients, the application too. And then we go into the production line. And from there, kita akan tengok the factory is actually able to produce many type of robots. Yeah. So dia a bit different. Bagi saya, industri robot ni kalau kita nak produce, the factory itself need to have capability to multiply dia model ataupun dia applications according to the market punya needs. Dia bukan hanya satu macam kita keluarkan proton, kan, satu model satu line, eh? Tak boleh macam tu. Dia kena ada customization to be ability to customize inside the factory itself.
Right. Okay. So the next question from Yi Siang Tan. In Malaysia, which industries will benefit the most from robot and automation during COVID-19? Who are the startups out there that working on it? KJ, would you like to answer on that?
Oh,
maybe.
Mana industri? As I mentioned just now lah, kan. Kalau tengok soalan dia ni lebih kepada manufacturing. So some of the manufacturing has done it, has used it. Kalau tengok macam semicon company, automotive company, automotive manufacturing. And some of the manufacturing yang buat food production pun ada yang juga pakai. Kalau pergi Gardenia tu memang most of them are robotic. Yeah. Satu dia tak ada hal pun. Right. The supply is just nice.
Okay.
So that's about it lah.
Okay, and maybe Dr. Madan, you want to answer the last question by Dr. Kamil Mahmud. Any examples that you can share the robot deployment in agriculture in Malaysia and they are sustaining? Maybe do you have?
Soalan jadi tu okay. Bila kata in Malaysia and sustaining tu, another question lah.
Okay.
So, I think kalau just to add up what KJ mentioned, kalau in term of manufacturing, kita banyak robot macam Dr. Anafia mentioned, robot can be in defense, manufacturing sector, service sectors and all, you know, so different sectors. So yeah, through in manufacturing is one of them. And then in agriculture, you can see that because robots ni can comes in many forms, right? So dulu masa kita punya mentality, kita kata robot tu macam orang, tapi sepatutnya tak mesti macam orang. Dia can be just normal vehicle, a robot that can move around, that can become, dia boleh membajak tapi dia robot, kan? Dia boleh. So now what you're seeing is that different phases of maturity of robots ni being implemented in agriculture. The last one I mentioned last time in the agriculture punya siri tu, kita kata a vehicle that can, you know, just have simple sensors to monitor, you know that your assets, then you can control your vehicle, that you know that kalau orang curi, you can immobilize the assets, and then you can optimize your assets of the apa tu tractor dan sebagainya. Then after the fourth one, you will see that the vehicle become autonomous. That autonomous part is where the robot comes in. So you don't need any more people utilizing this. But unfortunately, maybe in Malaysia, we have yet to come to that level. You know, as I mentioned just now, that is only on the fourth level of maturity. So a simple a monitoring of equipments and all that, is it there? So kita ada belum lagi yang kita nampak yang ni. Tapi kalau kita tengok macam dekat negara China, negara Australia dan sebagainya, yang dia punya ladang besar-besar, machines yang digunakan, tapi guna automation lah, banyakkan automation kan. Yang boleh apa tu membajak dan mengambil buah hasil dan sebagainya. Tapi yang robot ni mungkin lain sikit. Tapi saya rasa kalau nak tengokkan servis robot ni, dia bukan setakat untuk ni ya, dia macam kita rasa takut bit kuman ni, virus ni. Orang yang memasak pun kita takut. Now you can see that the tukang masak ni, chef ni, is robots, right? And then people service, your people, the customer service, kita takut nak berjumpa, then robot will replace them. So all of this is where the post-COVID-19 will, you know, will make that wake-up call. So we don't want to become the old norm back lah. Kan, the old normal. Kata je new normal, but back to old normal.
Yeah. Okay. Alright. I guess it's like already 3:30 lah, Doctor. Perhaps it's time for us to wrap up. Shall we start with Dr. Hanafiah, please? Let's wrap up.
Okay. The main question here is what's going to happen after this lah. The MCO. I think business want to recover and they have to gain confidence of people to come to the premises. And in order to recover, they need to have a good perceptions of people that their service is clean. You know, they have taken certain precaution to for disinfection and sebagainya. Eh? Jadi trend yang saya jangka akan lihat selepas ni, robot akan banyak digunakan di public area, bukan hanya untuk cleaning ataupun you know, make sure people following the discipline, tapi juga untuk membuatkan orang rasa selesa dan rasa selamat untuk pergi, untuk deal the business, untuk pergi makan ke restoran, untuk pergi ke bank, even nak pergi ke jabatan kerajaan sekalipun kan. Kalau tengok kat dalam tu ada robot buat cleaning kan, and then reception dia pun robot, kata okay, this organisation is actually taking very seriously into fighting COVID-19. So that perception yang mana kita perlu ada yang akan jadi trend dalam business selepas ni, dan kita harap the apa tu perception of people melihat robot ni akan berubah selepas ni, ya. Bukan hanya kita tengok sebagai a symbol of entertainment ataupun something yang kita tengok terlalu mahal, ya. Banyak orang kata robot ni mahal, memang mahal, ya. Sebab dia teknologi, tak ada teknologi yang murah, ya. Tapi di sebalik tu impact dia, kita perlu lihat impact dia, kan. Kalau kita pergi mall yang besar-besar kan, kalau kita tengok dalam tu ada actively robot buat cleaning, actively robot buat surveillance dan sebagainya kan, kita tak mampu rasanya nak letak ramai sangat orang, polis ke guard nak buat semua tu, eh?
Yes.
Jadi akan bagi more confidence to people to go out and make sure that kita follow the discipline of COVID-19, eh? Jadi itu yang saya rasa akan jadi trend selepas ni.
Okay, cool. How about you, KJ?
Oh, much simple. Macam sebelum ni saya cakap, teknologi ni akan menyusahkan tapi sebenarnya menyenangkan. It's all on us, depend how we look at the technology lah, especially on the robot.
Right.
Macam
right.
Tadi memang Dr. Nika kata, orang kata nampak robot ni mahal, tapi when you study back on the ROI, dia jadi